throughout the liturgy. There is no congregational singing. The only singing is by the cantor. There is no collection during Mass. As we leave the church, the ushers will be standing outside with the offertory baskets. Please do not shake hands for the sign of peace. Simply bow to one another. Receiving Holy Communion, use the center aisle. Father will distribute Holy Communion to the Mary side of the church. Then Father will move to your right and distribute Communion to the St. Joseph side of the church. Stop at green markings on the floor that say, Amen. Extend your hands to receive Communion. You may then unhook your mass and consume the Eucharist as you return to your pew. Exit in the church. At the end
God, by whom we are redeemed and receive adoption, look graciously upon your beloved sons and daughters, that those who believe in Christ may receive true freedom and an everlasting inheritance. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord, so you, O son of man, I have made a watchman for the house of Israel. Whenever you hear a word from my mouth, you should give them warning from me. If I say to the wicked, O wicked one, you should surely die, and you do not speak to warn the wicked to turn from their ways, the wicked person shall die in their iniquity. But their blood I will require at your hand. But if you warn the wicked person to turn from their ways, and they do not turn from their ways, they shall die in their iniquity. But you will not see your life. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh, that day you would listen to the voice of the Lord. Do not harden your hearts.
Oh, that day you listen to the voice of the Lord.
Do not harden your hearts. Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. Oh, that they would listen to the voice of the Lord. Do not harden your hearts. Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Oh, that today we listen to the voice of the Lord, do not harden your hearts. Oh, that today we would listen to his voice, do not harden your hearts, as at Meribah, as on the day at Massa in the wilderness, when your ancestors tested me and put me to the proof, though they had seen my work. Oh, that today you would listen to the voice of the Lord, do not harden your hearts.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, owe no one anything except to love one another. For one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments: you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandments are summed up in this word: love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Jesus spoke to his disciples, "If your brother or sister sins against you, go and point out the fault when the two of you are alone. If he or she listens to you, you have regained your brother or sister. But if the person does not listen, take one or two others along with you, so that every word may be confirmed by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If the person refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if that person refuses to listen even to the church, let such a one be to you as a Gentile or a tax collector. Truly I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly I tell you, if two of you agree on earth about anything you ask, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them." The Gospel of the Lord. Of our society. course, when we look at the greater our culture, the greater society at large, we know that there is something deeply unsettling. Perhaps a certain rot at taking hold. Pope John Paul II would call this the culture of death, that we live in a time where people are becoming more and more numb to this spiritual death. People, when this term, the culture of death, is brought up, will often link it to abortion or contraception. But those are not the things that Pope John Paul II only focuses on. He's talking about a greater culture at large, this culture of being indifferent, of being numb to the danger of sin. And so it's a lot more than just a couple of social issues. It's an entire wave of life. Are we as a society moving towards life, becoming more and more morally upstanding? Or do we shy away from that and kind of have a laissez-faire attitude, letting people do whatever they want? Because a throwaway culture, a culture of indifference, a culture where individual responsibilities is slowly diminished, that is going to lead to a sort of death, a death to caring, a death to responsibility, a death to justice, a death to love itself. And so when the church proclaims certain teachings about morality, it's not so much that the church wants to get into anybody's business, right? Because sometimes there's this wrong perception that, you know, who are you to tell me what to do? But the church does have a clear responsibility, right, to be the heralds of this message of salvation, of life, to tell people that there is a better way forward, that we must turn back away from our ways of sin towards Jesus Christ, towards the way, the truth, and the life. And so this is it. This is our mission too, right? As we, as individual members of the church, we are given this responsibility, starting with ourselves. Then extending slowly upward. Notice that Jesus in the gospel does the same thing, right? When one person sins against another, he says, let's deal with it on a small scale first, one-on-one. Then if it needs to be escalated, then involve a few others. And finally, perhaps, involve the church to kind of turn this person back. Why do we have to do this? It's not because we want to be overly critical or get into everybody's business, but rather, what we ask everything to do with love. We don't want any one of us to perish on our spiritual journey. We want us all to grow it in the right direction. And of course, we know that every sin does have a social damage. But there is nothing hidden under the sun that doesn't have an impact on each other. And ultimately, of course, we have to be accountable before God. So, given all of that, as we go forth this week, we have to perhaps first turn in or look into our hearts, see which direction in which we ought to be going, and perhaps, of course, think about the sacrament of reconciliation, this beautiful sacrament that turns us back towards the right direction. One-on-one with God saying, I'm sorry, I want to come back towards you. And then from that, we pray.
and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. O God, who give us the gift of true prayer and of peace, graciously grant that through this offering we may do fitting homage to your divine majesty, and by partaking of the sacred mystery, we may be faithfully united in mind and heart through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Hear the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you so love the world that in your mercy you sent us the Redeemer to live like us in all things but sin, so that you might love in us what you loved in your Son, by whose obedience we have been restored to those gifts of yours that by sinning we lost in disobedience. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks as an exaltation we acclaim. Holy,
holy, holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we brought to you for consecration, that they may become for us the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. We proclaim
the name of the Lord and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church and recognizing the sacrificial victim, by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, Saint Bernadette, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. In this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Thomas, our Bishop, the order of bishops, the clergy, and the entire people who have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you summon before you, in your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Amen. unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to pray. Lamb of God.
easiest way to do that is through the link on the website, but you're also welcome to call the parish office and have Myrna help you with that or do that for you. The office is open, as you probably know, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday from 9 till 4. Otherwise, leave a message and Myrna, Father Raymond, or myself will get back to you on that. As you may have noticed this morning, we asked for the tickets. We have to keep track of everybody that's coming in, especially now going forward into the fall as we're kind of all, you know, we're beginning to come back. It's pretty important, so we're being asked to do that. Thank you for your patience. I want to ask that we continue to pray for our RCIA catechumens and candidates. We'll be looking to receive our newest members into the church by the end of the month in a separate Mass from our parish Mass, given the COVID restrictions on gatherings. It's certainly not the ideal, but as a community, we want to continue to support our newest members, and so I'm asking that we lift them up in prayer and keep them in our prayers. I'd also like to thank the Ministers of Hospitality and some of our young people who are going to be helping us to follow these government and archdiocesan protocols and making sure everybody's registered. Again, I'd like to thank you for your patience and cooperation, especially in these times. One of the things that Cardinal Collins has said in some of his messages to us in the Archdiocese is that following these procedures, even though they can be a bit frustrating for us all, they really are an effort.